Greetings and welcome to the Department of Tangents podcast, episode 51, part 2 of my interview with inventor and philosopher Dr. Robert Doyle, plus new music from Ruby Boots. I'm your host, Nick Zeno, and I'm excited for you to hear the rest of this interview. Part 1 went up earlier this week, and while part 2 could stand alone, Dr. Doyle was a fascinating subject. If you're a student of communication history, of social media, you really owe it to yourself to hear what the man has to say. If you haven't listened to part one, let me explain. No, there is too much to let me sum up. I first got in touch with Dr. Doyle when I found out he invented my favorite board game from when I was a kid, which is called Stop Thief, and I found through a short history in the recently released updated version of that from Restoration Games that he lives in the Boston area. I got in touch, scheduled the interview, and then started researching and found he also invented the game Merlin, created Mac Publisher, the first desktop publishing program, helped create podcasting with Christopher Lydon. He has a PhD in astrophysics and is an information philosopher and a strong advocate for the concept of free will. We talked about all of that, the effect of social media, MTV, VJ, Adam Curry, and even the theory behind improv games. And in part two, we start out talking about Stop Thief and some of the games he's designed, including some that were never put into production. And this episode's featured track is from a rocking singer-songwriter by the name of Ruby Boots called It's So Cruel from her sophomore album, Don't Talk About It. Stay tuned for that after the conversation. And now, part two of Dr. Robert Doyle. One of the strange things about this interview is that the whole reason this happened was because of a Christmas present I got this year that I spent years talking about a game called Stop Thief and trying to explain to my friends how great it was, and I used to play it when I was a kid, and I had no idea that it had been rebooted in the last, what, in 2016? Was that when it was?
17.
2017, just last year. And my wife found it, and inside there was a biography of the game that mentioned you and that you were in Massachusetts. I was very excited on Christmas Day to learn that that was that you were here. I got in touch with the people from Restoration Games, and here we are. I had no idea of the scope of the things that you had done. Do you get, when people recognize you or contact you, is it generally because they're big fans of Merlin, which you invented, or big fans of Stop Thief? Or
it's a whole variety of things, Nick. People do write to me and thank me for the games. It hasn't happened that much lately because they're not out there that much.
Uh-huh.
Mostly they come in from people who read my websites and so forth, and I do get lots of nice notes, so that's good. But, you know, the games were like... I originally called what we were doing microcosmos, because games are like a little version of the big world that I study, okay? And into the games, we tried to put in lots of different things. Many inventors who approached Parker Brothers came in with an idea, and it was the only idea they had. And Parker Brothers learned not to work with such people. And I learned to tell Parker Brothers that I'm not just the person who's inventing a game. I'm trying to enable a new way to do games by intersecting the bored feeling of having a game with a computer and so forth. And that I had already conceived a dozen games, and I prototyped four, many of which were stolen by the people I showed them to, because I signed non-disclosure agreements and they were allowed to do whatever they wanted. So it was always not a game I was doing. It was trying to push the kind of way, the ways we did games. So take Stop Thief, the one you like.
Yes.
Look at the strange notion that I put into that one that said, what the players will get is sounds.
Yes. And just to tell people a little bit of who don't know.
Yeah.
The 1979 version that I played, it had a little scanner that looked like a cordless phone. Would a little bit years later, there was a board with a grid on it. You would punch numbers in a grid onto the handheld unit and try to guess where the thief was on this grid. And sounds would tell you, you had sounds for when it committed a crime, for when they to had footsteps when they broke glass.
Opened the door.
Rode the subway. So that's the premise for people who did.
Yeah. So you see what I'm doing there is just imagining something that I can imagine doing it, but no one ever done a thing like that where you would have clues to what was going on, purely audible clues, and then you'd have to look at the board and see where subway was close to a door or to broken window or to the crime alarm going off and so forth. And that was, I could show you, you might be interested, I wrote up over 200 game ideas, weird different ones. Most of them have never been done. It's one of those areas that it's just there. I don't have the time anymore at my age to do those things, but I wrote up lots of them. And they were diverse. Let me give you one. We had one called Teach Me, Touch Me, Teach Me, Doll. So it was a doll. Why am I inventing a doll? Because I'm saying, you know, sounds can be used to do interesting things. So we imagine a doll, and it's nice and soft and pink and whatever. And what you do is, what I used to do with my son, I would say, where's my nose? And there came a time, maybe 11, 12 months, where my son would touch my nose. And I'd say, you know, where's my ears? And, you know, so I decided, let's do a touch me, teach me. And what we'll do is have a little doll. And the doll would say, where's my nose? And you would touch the nose and you'd get a nice, like Merlin, you did it, you won, you got my nose. Or the kid would touch the ear and say, no, that's my ears. So I would have a little doll that would teach a prelingual young person, a really not a toy playing age person, but an infant, to react and interact with this little doll, and it would teach us teach that child the names for all our body parts. Well, you know, earlier, you just a moment ago, you asked, what if there are negative things involved? Well, I explored those too. So we had the touch in the wrong place, and the doll saying, no, don't touch me there. Possibilities. My script for the touch me, teach me doll, just like my little master's thesis I wrote on the game of pinball, so that we put in every one of the elements into our wildfire pinball game, including a tilt, which there's no mechanical way to do it. So anyway, touch me, teach me never appeared. It still could appear in some doll company. I stopped talking to toy companies because we made an outrageous amount of money, and I've just used it to build other things that I think are powerful tools that help people do things, primarily communicate. That's what I would like to enable everyone to communicate. So that's why I went on from games to Mac Publisher and the telecomputer, the terminal. As I mentioned, I think because people were deaf and couldn't communicate except by a teletype machine. That's been my direction. See if I can build something that will give someone tools that improve their lives.
Were you surprised when Restoration Games approached you and said that they wanted to do Stop Thief?
Well, others had thought of that, and I had imagined that we would bring out versions of our games at some time. People might want to, but that they never worked out. But Justin convinced me he was really serious about wanting to do this, and he had a lot of good reasons. So he asked if I would, you know, almost sell him the rights or something. I said no, but I'd be glad to give them to you if you would go out and bring it back into the world. That'll be enough reward for me.
When you create a game, what's the initial inspiration? Is it different, would you say, than sitting down and trying to think of a hook to a song or a punchline to a joke?
Those must be very similar things. I think artists who try to push into a new space, a feeling of, gee, we could do something a little different. Yeah, it's like that. I also have a rule that I developed from a professor named Gordon, I'm trying to remember his name, called Synectics. And I find that when you sit with another person or persons and try to think up new things, the people who listen to them always want to say no. They want to say, no, there's something wrong with that. That's why it hasn't happened already. And Synectics was a scheme that was developed to be encouraging new ideas. When a new idea appears, Nick, it's like a tiny little baby, totally without any strength or support. And it's so easy to kill a new idea. Any dummy can say no. There's something wrong with that. So Synectics, this fellow's idea was, we're not allowed to say no. We're not allowed to say but. Mm-hmm. We're only allowed to say and. And, well, maybe this could also do that. And so my little group, which was my wife, my brother-in-law, and on earlier companies, a physicist friend from MIT who lives across the street, we had this rule that if we're trying to push the envelope, let's not, nothing negative allowed during our brainstorming. So brainstorming became a process under rules of my rules. It was Synectics rules. We just try to say, oh, with that, we could then also do that. And it's amazing how fast things can grow right before your eyes. And suddenly you've got things on your notes. But today, it's very difficult with all of my philosophy to find somebody who isn't ready to criticize because they're armed with things they already know.
Right.
And that getting into what I created in the form of a brainstorming session, which I always do with myself. You mentioned, what about the negative things? Well, I put them down, but I try to get away from them as fast as possible and think about how this could also lead to that.
Have you ever studied improv comedy?
No, but I've seen a nice movie on it, and I appreciate how they do. They build on one another, right? There was a great movie about it recently, right?
Yeah, Don't Think Twice, the Microbiglia movie.
Yeah.
Well, one of the concepts that goes back to like Viola Spolin. Oh, smacked my mic with my pen, that goes back to Viola Spolin and the original Second City and the Compass Players was right. the yes and.
Yes, I agree. I've been doing that for long years, so I really like that film on the improv, which was all a fake improv of sorts because it was scripted, but
yes,
but it was well done, very well done.
Well, you might be interested to read a little bit about that, about the about
Second City or
Second City. Well, just the game. Viola Spolin was someone who created sort of improv games and the philosophy of yes and, where you don't, if somebody says, "What a beautiful day it is today," your scene partner, it's bad form to say, "No, it isn't. It's raining," and then try to change it. You can't deny. Once somebody has created a reality, you have to work within that reality. If somebody says, "I put them on the table over there," and you say, "There's no table over there. There's this," because you have your own idea, then you're grandstanding. You're not a good scene partner.
Exactly. Viola Spolin. How do you spell that?
Spolin.
I will look up her book, and I definitely was doing something like that in my efforts whenever I work with people, because thought just came in and out of my head that the tendency of academics, so they're something better, more civilized than out in the world arguments, but there's a real tendency to want to put your own idea out there and stop the one that you're hearing. Mm-hmm. I used to think that companies, organizations have a kind of a built-in antivirus system, that you can think of a new idea as a virus, right? And so when you bring a new idea to a company, it's like it's got its own immune system, and it's ready to just knock that one down. So the vision of yes and, as Viola Spolin calls it, is definitely a way to opening up creativity, in my opinion. Yeah, I like that. Thanks for the reference.
Oh, you're welcome. I want to get into a couple more things here. I want to talk about information philosophy. You call yourself an information philosopher. Is there a simple way to distill that, to tell people what that means?
Yeah, I guess philosophy for the past 2,000 years has been something that we do with words. We argue, make arguments. Ever since Aristotle, we think those arguments are logical, and if there's a correct way to approach them and possibly solve them for logical reasoning. And reasoning, of course, is a tool everyone uses to think, and to think scientifically and mathematically and logically, presumably, is a technique that will get us to the, quote, truth. Mm. Well, it turns out, in philosophy, there are not a lot of truths that have stood the test of really being establishable by scientific experiments and understanding the world. And so ancient philosophy thought they were making advances, and Aristotle invented logic, and it was a great thing. And in the late 19th century, there came a view that science should now be able to figure things out in philosophy, and we'd really come to answers which would change our way of living, really, in some serious way. So I've always been very interested in it. But in the 20th century, there came an idea that the mind was an imaginary, called metaphysical thing, that it's immaterial, it's ghostly. They called it not a mind, only a mind, but a spirit, a soul. Well, people attached that to the idea of an immortal soul, that we would survive death and so forth. And that was a wonderful sales idea to get someone to follow you. Anyone who told you, I've got a ticket here, boy, and you're going to be able to live forever if you come along with me. That was one of the greatest successes in new ideas. But it was only an idea. The whole realm of ideas and their relationship to the world as it is, where we're living in, is a thing that I would like to understand for myself, and I would like to explain it to other people if it make them better educated about the world. So logic, since Aristotle, was thought to give us truths. It does not give us any truth about the world. The world is not logically put together. When it is, we can use it to understand the world, but there are some parts of the world that are just the way the world is, and it isn't commanded to be that by some law of reason or law of logic. Logic is a great tool, mathematics is a great tool, but they're just ideas. They do work in the world. Then words were used to describe philosophy and how we understand the world, but words are wonderfully ambiguous. The ambiguity makes them jump to metaphors and ways of talking and ways of thinking, which are fantastic. But it turns out that doesn't get us to understand the way the world is working. So philosophy in the 20th century, since Russell and Wittgenstein and philosophers started to argue, we need to have these arguments. It's called language, analytic language philosophy, where we get our concepts all perfect and then we'll know things. It turned out to be a big bust. The great philosophers, even in America today, in philosophy departments, think they can reason to knowing about the world. And I'm basically saying, no, you've got to get to whatever it is that made language possible and logic possible. And it wasn't the words. It's the underlying structures in the world. Structures which for the first 9 billion years were all created by forces like gravity and electromagnetic forces, nuclear forces. Everything out there in the world before life began was created by something. It was a product. It created information structures. Then, 3.5 billion years ago, a longish molecule on the surface of the Earth accidentally duplicated itself. And we had twice as much information. And now that replicated to the point where the information in one of these molecules carried the code of how to make another one. And all of a sudden, whereas before information had been passive and created by other forces, now information was involved in creating the new information structures. And so I regarded that as a great insight. I saw this vision of saying, let's talk about how it is that pure information, ideas encoded in some sort of molecular arrangement, suddenly led to creating more of themselves. And that comes as an explanation all the way up to you and me having a conversation. We're still just information structures in our brains, in our DNA. We have biological ones, and then we have these mental ones. And I started to see that the mental ones, our ideas, are abstract information. They're like what the metaphysicists used to say was our mind or our soul. And I find out, wow, I actually thought souls were a ridiculous idea invented by a great marketing person who got people to join their religion.
Well, that was one of the things I found inspiring about the lecture. There was a point where you say that information is the closest thing that a scientist has
to a spirit,
to believing in a soul. And because that's what leaves when you die. Your matter that makes up your physical body decays, and the thing that leaves is the information that you were carrying around.
Yeah, and I have this notion. That's great that you see that step in my thinking, Nick. But I have this notion that the idea of immortal soul is those who are, quote, immortals in our history, like Achilles and fighting in the Iliad and the Homer, they are immortal because information about them has become a permanent part of our society. And the kind of immortality, there's this wonderful joke by Woody Allen, you know, he says, I don't want to be immortal because of my works, like Homer, right? I don't want to be immortal through my children, you know, because they're genetic. I want to be immortal through not dying. So my point is, until we get to the point where we don't die, and by the way, I don't think that's far away. I do think we talked a little about the octopus with all the extra DNA and this axolotl little creature who can completely rebuild an arm, a tail. You cut anything off, it rebuilds it. It's amazing. We may get there to those who want to live forever will be allowed to live forever, should they choose to. But that does tell you that the soul that you have, the spirit in you, is really you as the product of what you've learned throughout your life. You are a person with a... Clearly, it's a lot like what people thought was an immortal soul. But I'm giving you a mortal soul. And I'd like to bring back soul and mind and spirit as reasonable words to describe what makes us human beings. Yeah.
And where does free will come in? That's another concept you spend quite a lot of time on.
Yeah, it turned out I made that my first book because I'd been thinking about it since 1957. And I just basically watched others struggling with it. And most philosophers who write about it have been convinced that science explains everything and that we're all determined by the laws of physics and science. And unfortunately, that's not correct. We are not predetermined. It's easy to think that because it fits into a view that everything in the world has been all figured out at day one. You know, what was written on the wall in the original Book of Knowledge is all there, and it's all happening. This interview was fully understood or known by a superintelligence, whether it's a religious intelligence or just Laplace's demon. Laplace's demon was an idea that once you knew all the particle positions and their velocities of every single elementary particle in the universe, clearly you would be able to retrodict the past and know the future, and there's only one possible future. No.
Well, the Super Bowl contradicts that because the closest we have to that is to knowing where all the particles are is Bill Belichick, and that didn't work for him
right
this past Sunday.
No, so, it's a great loss. Tom Brady is like a Greek hero in my view. He plays a wonderful, wonderful game, but you can't always win because chance is always involved. That one fumble, the one sack, the one loss of the ball, it changed the entire game, right?
That's what it comes down to, you know. Any team in the league might have had a chance to be in the Super Bowl. You could probably isolate a few points where a half a dozen other teams came down to one fumble, what? One errant pass, one sack, one thing that, you know, it's that chaos theory. You know, it changed. This changes all the possibilities.
Butterfly wing in Peking, yeah. And we get a storm in New Hampshire.
I was interested also in did William James create that two-stage theory of free will, or did you create that based on things he had said?
Okay, let's clear that up. First of all, the idea of quantum mechanics providing a kind of element of freedom, which hadn't been thought about before, was the work of a guy named Arthur Stanley Eddington, who was a great astrophysicist and astronomer. He wrote a book called The Nature of the Physical World, and he said, well, we've just learned from Heisenberg that there's this indeterminacy and that things happen at random. Mm-hmm. All right. Now, Eddington had given the most famous lectures in philosophy, are called the Gifford Lectures in Scotland, and he'd been asked to give the Gifford Lectures, and he wrote up his talks, and he said everything's determined. He was a determinist, okay? Arthur Stanley Eddington was a scientist. He believed everything depended on all the elementary particles, and if you knew them all, you'd know what was going to happen tomorrow. But when he finished his talk about determinism, he read Heisenberg's paper, and he said, oh, my gosh. So when he published the book, he mentions, in proof, we change it, and now we say a little chink open because the electrons are doing things that are totally by chance. All right. He got attacked by all the other philosophers saying, you think a free electron is going to make us free? You just don't know what you're talking about. And he backed off. He was very... Okay, so I had read that Eddington in my junior year at Brown, and I thought there was something right about that. And the other thing he wrote about was the second law of thermodynamics. Eddington said, how is it that the entropy is always going up? And what a strange law. It isn't like Newton's laws of motion. Hmm. It's a kind of talking about the quality of going from good things to bad. And it had an element of ethics and value in it. Hmm. Well, I had taken another course in ethics. And the thought was that ethics is and not something you can ever figure out scientifically. It's just a cultural judgment by a society. Different societies have different values. So I set in motion my worrying about free will and values in 1957. Mm-hmm. In the 1960s, I then put together this idea that the randomness would generate possibilities, and then you would pick from them with a part of our mind. I used to call it the macro mind, the larger mind, which would be averages over the quantum events and so would be reliable. So you needed a kind of unreliable craziness. And I used to say freedom and creativity is to be crazy and just to do things at random. Uh-huh. But then some of those random things might look, wow, that might be worthwhile, right? Uh-huh. And you wouldn't go with it. You'd be a creative person. That was around 1960. And at the same time, I worked on the problem of entropy creation in the universe by asking this one simple question, which I write as the fundamental question of information philosophy. The universe was said to begin in total randomness, chaos, maximum entropy already at the time, mm-hmm. okay? And yet, we're having this conversation. So I used to say to the professors, how did we get away from equilibrium? We all know the second law. I had taken physics. Once you're at equilibrium, that's the end state. That's the heat death. That's the end of everything. Everything's all smushed out, right? How can we be creating more information? I used to call it negative entropy. I didn't stumble on the phrase information as the thing that is a good as opposed to the chaos of, mm-hmm. of entropy. And Norbert Wiener at MIT had written this book in which he said, you know, entropy is the devil incarnate. And I thought there is this kind of values feeling about entropy. It just messes things up. So how do we keep cleaning things up? How does that work? And it turns out it depends on the sun sending us negative entropy, which is mathematically equivalent to information, Shannon's information. And I was on to a whole view that was a comprehensive view of values for us as living things, in addition to the notion that we're free to create new things, and we have a hand and we're kind of co-creators of the universe, the universe we live in on this planet. We're building it. For better or worse, we're building it awful fast.
Well, there's how are we cleaning it up, and why are we cleaning it up?
Mm-hmm. How do we?
Why are we cleaning up entropy?
Our bodies are keeping us alive because from the moment that first molecule made a copy of itself, and then we kind of jump ahead to cells forming, and there's a wonderful phrase by. A Nobel Prize winner on the guys who understood the cell and DNA and so forth beyond Crick and Watson. Jacques Monod and his partner François Jacob, the French guys, they said there's a purpose in every cell, and the purpose is to become two cells. Mm. And you can imagine that as a kind of striving forward motion, trying to do things. So this is going on ever since we were cells, and we're still doing the same thing. So today, most of what goes on in me is all biological information working to replace the broken cells. I have this line that points out that every second, 200 million of your red blood cells, which is the main driving energy source, die. They fall apart. In 1 second, 200 million. And inside each one of those red blood cells, which is a tiny little guy, there's 300 million hemoglobin proteins or enzymes. And each one of those has 300 amino acids that make it up. It's a wonderful little machine. And we have no appreciation of this fact that there's a data rate, new creation of information, replacement information mostly, going on. This is way beyond anything all our computers are doing. It's going on inside us, and it's just information replacing itself. And we are benefit from that. So you ask, why do we clean up? Well, living things have found a way to live in whatever environment they're in, and to get better and better and better at what they do following Darwinian evolution, which is random branches on the trees of life, right? All the different kinds of life over the ages. And we're part of that. So that's sort of my basic kind of reason for saying information philosophy is where we should start to understand what's going on.
Well, how do we get from that deviation from equilibrium to the William James idea?
Oh, yeah. So the specifically, right. We're
the
going
two part,
to.
Which if I understand it correctly.
It's a two-stage model. Yeah, randoms first and then evaluating the alternative possibilities. So in the 1970s, Dan Dennett came up with a book called Brainstorms, in which he described this process. And I thought, okay, I don't have to do any more work on this because it's going to get out there. And I'm fine. I have a lot of ideas, as you know. And when someone else does one of them, I say, fine, that one's taken care of. I don't have to do any more there. But a few years went by, and I can't exactly remember, but it may be as late as the 80s, that I started to seriously write up notes on my thoughts about things. Mm-hmm. And I started reading philosophers on free will. Mm-hmm. And you see the library upstairs, you know, 500 books by lots of other people on free will. And in Dan Dennett's book, he described two stages in which the first stage, a computer randomly generates possibilities. Mm-hmm. And in the second stage, a different thinking process evaluates them. And I said, that's great. That's my work. But when I came back to it, because I wanted to try to tell more, I read lots of people and I discovered about 20, 30 people who have written around this idea of separating the creation of ideas from the evaluation of the ideas. Mm-hmm. And the earliest one that wrote about it was William James. And he wrote it very nicely, although Dan Dennett's description is still the very best one. Mm-hmm. So I then started giving William James credit, and I got invited by Harvard to the 100th anniversary of William James' death, 1910 to 2010, and I got to speak on my two-stage model, and it got published by William James Studies. I started to take myself seriously in this area. So the answer to your question is why William James, I found him much later, and between my thinking of it, came quite a few other people. About half of them were after me, like Dan Dennett, and half of them were before me. A guy named David Wiggins, a guy named Arthur Holly Compton, who understood the electron and its randomness and back in like the 20s. And so I've got this picture of a history of the two-stage model, and I'm like in the middle of it. And I came in and found people worked on it already, and others were still working on it. Most of them do not have a very good thought, well thought out argument for it, though. So I hope I provide that. Now, you want to ask another thing. Let me close that off with this. Dan Dennett invited me to his class, and he doesn't accept the importance of quantum mechanics. Hmm. Bob Kane wrote the Oxford Handbook, and I came to write to him and invite him here and put him up at the faculty club and make a video right in my chair of his theory. I identified these people, and 4 years ago, a French filmmaker decided to make a film about free will, and he interviewed Dan Dennett, Bob Kane, Alfred Mealy, and five others, and me, and that film is coming out, and it'll be shown at the MIT Philosophy Department in the first week in April, and we're going to fly these guys all together, and I'm going to try to get them to agree on a joint statement on free will coming out of MIT and Harvard, whatever. And I hope we'll make them accept what I'm trying to do to pull them all together. So that'll be kind of fun. And I have that already, the pre-release version of all of that. And
what's the name of the film?
It's called PSI, Psi, as in psychology, sort of, the Greek letter, The Project. You go to psi-project.com, you'll see the whole story. And there are these nine philosophers, including me and Dennett and all. But I'm trying to get people to realize, people like James, they're not around anymore, but they deserve the credit for thinking of it first. So that's let's close the story on William James.
Is there a practical application for why, you know, the average Joe walking around on the day-to-day would apply this or think about this?
It's a big subject in ethics and ultimately more beyond the morality to the, you know, best way to manage thinking about our lives in what's called the question of moral responsibility. And the argument goes, you can't be responsible if you're not free. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of liberal thinkers who do not want to blame people for things they do wrong. And they want to absolve them and say, you did it because you got abused as a kid. You mm-hmm. did it because you become an addict to alcohol or drugs. You did it for another reason. You didn't do it. You don't deserve to go to jail. Uh-huh. There's a kind of left-winging group of people, left-wing sort of, who want to absolve everyone of any responsibility because we're just machines. Mm-hmm. Then there's more or less on the conservative side of the political spectrum, there are those who want to punish people who have done things wrong according to the standards of our society. Now, in that little group, they want to say, you're morally responsible for what you just did, and so you need to be punished. Then there's a division among the punishers who say, well, you shouldn't punish someone just to get revenge. It's mm-hmm. not just an eye for an eye, because that's two wrongs don't make a right. But you could punish someone if the consequences of punishing them has made them change their ways. Mm-hmm. And then we punish for rehabilitation. We try to re-educate as opposed to just chopping a hand off because they stole something and so forth. So there's a very large argument that lies behind the philosophy of morality and cultural norms and so forth. Mm-hmm. And I like to say, I don't have much to say about that because different societies have had their own rules. Religions have their own rules. Some societies live a very different way from mine. But I do want to tell you, we do have freedom. Mm-hmm. And since that then is on the way to making you responsible, I get guys attacking me who saying, no, 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 we're absolutely, totally determined. You know, no, you're wrong. And they've learned that they want to be thought of as machines so that they don't have anything to do with the fact that they abused somebody or something. It's a complex area, but it's beyond just philosophy and physics today.
How does it apply to creativity, do you think?
Well, it's a very nice relationship to creativity because the creation of the first molecule that could duplicate itself was a creative thing that brought another kind of information into the world. You could say that the galaxies were formed by giant gravity, and that was kind of creative, but it's kind of pretty but uninteresting from the point of us as thinking beings. But every step along the way, creativity has demanded a certain new thing that wasn't there before, as that's more or less the definition, right? So I'd like to say every one of us is creative because there are things we do that we weren't programmed to do in our DNA, right? And we weren't even programmed to do by our parents or our schools or whatever. There are some things we do because it's just popped into our heads. That's the way James describes it. He says the brain is a blooming, buzzing confusion of all kinds of possibilities. And every now and then we notice one and we focus our attention on it. We bring it up and we may act on it. That's a wonderful insight. He's not a scientist, exactly. He just saw Darwin was creative. I mean, evolution is creative. It's brought all kinds of species into the world, and now we bring ideas into the world. That's the thing I like to think about.
How does it relate to humor? Do you have any thoughts on that? I've been reading Bergson's essay on the comic flexibility. Someone brought it up in an interview and asked if I had read it. Okay. And there's the idea that comedy or humor comes from a sort of deviation. The beginning of Bergson's essay talks about...
Which essay is that? It's not in Creative Evolution?
It's just on the comic. He's trying to get to why things are funny, which nobody ever quite does.
No.
But there's an interesting sort of theory that he puts that it's a deviation. He talks about absent-mindedness, which is very close to the core of why things might be funny, that somebody who is walking along and falls. Somebody might laugh because they obviously didn't plan to do
didn't
that.
Didn't expect that.
It was something. Or on a slightly higher level than that, somebody like a character like Don Quixote stumbles not because his muscles were expecting something else, but because he had his eye on a
distracted,
star somewhere and he
right.
was looking, and it's his morality.
Yeah.
That and it's sort of, things that play into it. There's a mental, a physical, and a character function to it. But it all has to do with flexibility and inflexibility. if you're an inflexible person, you that generates a certain friction.
Against that unexpected and laughing at something. There are a lot that, you know, the fact that we laugh when someone slips on a banana has always seemed strange. You're looking at someone getting hurt and you're laughing. But Henri Bergson was the French translator of William James. And so he knew all the James work, and he did a lot of good with it. And creative evolution, his heart is in the right place, but he's also a scientist who doesn't really know where science is going. So he doesn't really know anything about this randomness as something really an essential part of something new. I think he misses that. But I think I have a lot of notes on Bergson. I have three or four of his books, Memory and Matter, for example, and Creative Evolution. A lot of good stuff in there. I will write a webpage on him soon, and I'll try to add a little mention about comic. Not that I really understand it. That's a question better for you than for me.
It's very, for somebody who doesn't read philosophy a lot, it's a very thick sort of essay. So I'm working through it now and trying to understand.
Okay. And so send me the link to the title, and I will read it.
Sure.
We'll maybe produce a page on Bergson.
And there are a couple more things I have, and then we can to finish off. You'd said that in one of the lectures that you hope to be remembered as reconciling free will with true quantum randomness and indeterminism. If only one of your accomplishments survived, is that what you would like?
That's interesting. I'm not sure where I said that, but early on, I seem to stand alone among philosophers to take it seriously that you can reconcile randomness with responsibility. They have a very simple argument. It's called, I call it the standard argument against free will, and you'll find that on Wiki, on Google and everything.
Uh-huh.
If things happen if we are involved randomness in what happens, we aren't responsible for it.
Mm-hmm.
If, on the other hand, we're completely determined, well, we're not responsible for that either. So what they've done is to devise, I see in all their writings, that they can't see their way through to moral responsibility. And so it turns out all the other people in this film with me are really looking to explain moral responsibility. And they can be divided like this. Most of them think there is no moral responsibility. And some go so far as to say, we know there's no responsibility, but it would be a terrible service to society if we told everybody that we're all completely determined. So let's keep it a secret among ourselves as philosophers. Kind of interesting. Then the other group, Dan Dennett, he says, we're moral responsibility when we look and we see people being morally competent.
Mm-hmm.
And that free will is moral competence, which is strange. It surely is a deeper scientific question whether everything that happens is under the program of some laws of nature or super intelligence who's planned it all. So I have somehow not succeeded in convincing anyone else of my position. I'm still kind of not outside the academy. People write on my blog and say, oh, you're not really an academic. You're just an associate at the observatory. You know, you're not a professor. And I'm not a professor, although I have been. I'm a professor at University of Washington for a while. So to be remembered, I think today I would revise that. Free will is just one of maybe six or seven things that I've done. It happened to be the part of my website I wrote up as the first book.
Mm-hmm.
But today I would much rather be remembered for the way of thinking about information structures and where they came from.
Uh-huh.
Because firstly came from physical forces, and they were beautiful but uninteresting intellectually. Then life came about because information became a kind of agent in the universe managing the production of more of itself until it grows all the way up to be us thinking about things, right? So those two stages, if people saw that, and many people should, biologists should see it. I've been working with biologists and getting invited to a conference at Berkeley on semiosis, language, and information in biology. Many biologists do not like the idea of talking about information. They don't think Shannon information is explanatory, and it's a very technical mathematical thing. And they don't even like to talk much about entropy. So these things that I've learned from my cosmology background, need to be taught, understood by biologists. They think everything is explainable by chemistry. Biology is reducible to chemistry. Chemistry is reducible to physics. And so they tend to be determinists.
Uh-huh.
And I'm saying, no, no, there's more to life than all this determinism. So if I could be remembered, it would be from that moment when purpose entered the universe. Mm-hmm. There was no purpose in a galaxy. It's a fantastic thing, way beyond anything we could imagine in size and so on. There was no purpose, but when the first things started to duplicate themselves and be real, and they were now at this level of abstract information in charge rather than physical forces, that's the moment that mind-like things entered the universe. You can hardly say that a cell has a mind to duplicate itself, mm-hmm. but in the process of making assemblages of cells who pretty soon come to a thing that's got a lot of knowledge about how to go on, that's some thinking going on, and that's abstract, and that's information. It's not material, and that's my third stage in which I say, you know, this looks like a mind. It looks like what people thought of was a soul. It's your character. It's everything that's been remembered into your brain, and that's, to me, makes another level. So today I wish I would be remembered for sort of parsing out a story that starts with information structures passive, became active, and became thinking, and that's us.
Huh. If you're remembered as the guy who created Merlin, and that's the big thing, is that, would that make you happy? Would that make you sad? No.
I made a lot of people happy. I'm happy with all the things I've built and done. But the serious things at my age, I'm spending the rest of my life. I plan to, once this book is finished, I'll go back to 5 lectures a week. And I have 1,500 pages on information philosopher and a few hundred on metaphysicist, which I can lecture for until I'm gone. I really want to keep teaching people, and I'm working on that idea that I, instead of a one-hour lecture, I need to create one-minute, five-minute videos. Mm-hmm. Remember I mentioned the number that half the video is consumed on smartphones. Mm-hmm. Half the video consumed on smartphones is less than 1 minute, mm-hmm. or it's right around just minutes. So I'm in the wrong thing trying to give a lecture like I used to do, but I'm in the phase where I'm trying to find people interested in my work. But eventually I want to put together a message or messages about several very important things and see that they get used by others to teach people things.
And the new book is My God, He Plays Dice, How Albert Einstein Invented Most of Quantum Mechanics, and that's out this spring sometime?
I hope so. I've been promising that it's going to be out in the next few months for almost 2 years. I've been working on this book since 2015, and it's hard. I'm reading. I have everything Einstein wrote up to 1927, 26, and I've been working through him as my primary source. It's magnificent, wonderful stuff. I'm reading all his papers. Mm-hmm. And I have every book, a biography of Einstein, and I have a huge number of books on quantum mechanics which misdescribe his work. Mm-hmm. So I'm into this situation. It's really kind of interesting. He believes that there are objective things going on mm-hmm. which the quantum mechanics founders say we can't understand. They want it to be mysterious. They teach mysteries, which I've seen through the years. You can be a great professor and specialize in teaching one thing that nobody understands in philosophy. That can be a career. And they make a living out of that. But fundamentally, they really haven't thought as hard as I'm trying to think. And when I read Einstein, and I believe I will present how he really thought of these things first, and the famous guys like Heisenberg didn't know what he was talking about. And when Einstein talked to Heisenberg and wrote letters about him, he said, these people don't know what they're doing. And I'm collecting all of that to go into this book, hope to restore his reputation.
It's like a scientific hip-hop battle, like scientists that have a beef.
It could be. I don't want to reduce it to just nonsense, but it is amazing that today there are dozens of interpretations of quantum mechanics, and they all disagree with one another. So you know that only one at most could be right.
At most.
One, and maybe none of them really have got the whole story. So that's in the free will argument. There's a lot of different positions. And that's like a cottage industry of being academics. And, you know, there are 20,000, 30,000 philosophers in the U.S. and twice that number worldwide. They can't all be doing anything original and important. You know what I mean? I mean, they are doing something because they learned to do that. I don't mean to be mean about them. They are basically very little new creativity going on there. What they're good at is inventing new words and jargon. And they sell their book, and you've got to learn my way of talking about this. But
well, there's something to be said for presenting it in a new way.
Absolutely,
for a new,
and entertaining and all of that. Yes, and I appreciate that. But I'm really wanting to say, guys, I could tell you some more about what's going on if you really paid attention to Albert Einstein in this case. Or
now, to finish up, looking at all the things that we've talked about, and it's a vast amount of things we've talked about this past hour and a half. Is there anything all of these things that you've done have in common? Is there a common purpose for all the things you've done in your career?
Well, I think, as I've said, I made a lot of money with the toys, but the thing we sneaked into them as opposed to the entertainment was more important to me. I thought I was teaching people things so that they would be better able to do things. Great believer in computers, and of course, it's a way of storing knowledge and sharing knowledge in the future. So just as books once were the way we taught future generations, that's me. I want to be able to teach the best of things to the world. You know, Herbert Spencer said, what knowledge is most worth, is of most value? Mm-hmm. And I'm very interested in value, and it's knowledge that we put into the heads of our young new people. And so that's what I want to do. I particularly, in many cases, have said, why don't I build a tool that could make it easier or cheaper for them to do that? So I've made a successful or multiple businesses out of building tools for people to communicate particularly, but also to learn, become their own publisher of their own works, their own creator of their own media, and so forth. I love doing that. I get a lot of satisfaction out of it when somebody learns something from me or I provide tools. I just sent 10 cameras to Shakespeare and Company in Western Massachusetts. They take them each to a high school, and each high school learns a Shakespeare play under their direction, and these kids are transformed into actors. And then at around Thanksgiving time, all schools go to Lenox, to Shakespeare and Company, and they perform on the main stage there. Mm-hmm. And so I provided these tools so that the director can film students learning, and he's putting a package together of little how to teach an actor to deliver lines and other things like that. And it's being circulated. He plans to publish it to schools everywhere to allow people to learn how to act. And he's found that sometimes the toughest, most problematic kids in high school, the troublemakers, are great actors. And they act out those emotions, and they're terrific. And so a little specific that was needed that I learned from him. You cannot get young kids to read parts, memorize them, and then deliver them. Mm-hmm. So they've developed a technique. One of their actors stands behind the young kid, mm-hmm. and he says, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou? He whispers it into the ear. So the kid actually hears it told to him, and he goes through the acting. And they've got people behind one another, and you're relieved completely of having to know what you're going to say. Uh-huh. All you have to do is look like you mean it. And they get to be very good actors rather quickly. And that's wonderful. So I learned that he could do that. They know how this technique. And now we're documenting that technique. So it'll be spread around the schools as a way to take a young person and turn them into someone who's more concerned with the emotion and the passion and the moving and the swinging swords around. And that's a great thing that happened just a couple of years ago. And they're about to create their first set of tools that go out to schools. I'm not going to provide cameras to all of them, but the idea of recording it as a teaching tool, this Kevin came to me and said, Bob, I wish I could put this into a package that wasn't a book. You can't tell people about this. You need to show them. So.
And you're still learning.
Yeah.
And thank you very much for doing this. I really appreciate you spending so much time speaking with me.
It's great. I mean, I love it. Like you're a communicator, and you've developed your own tools with mostly your recording tools. One of these days, you may turn yourself into multimedia also.
Yeah.
And come to me and see I buy one of everything that's happening in this field. And I'm about Harvard Crimson president. For 4 years, I've asked Harvard to take these things. The new president will come tomorrow with his two multimedia people, and they're going to try to build a studio at the Harvard Crimson like this one. But in the meantime, I'm going to tell them they can sit here every night at 6 o'clock if they want to go on the air, on the internet, and be Harvard News of the day, visible in China, in Europe, right? Uh-huh. Isn't that an amazing opening possibility for a lot of people? I mean, you're already doing podcasts, so you have people who are, wherever they may be, able to listen to you. I'm trying to do the same thing for television.
Mm-hmm.
And live, not just on demand, mm-hmm. because the news element and sports are the things that people want to see them while they're happening.
Mm-hmm. More communication
to
more people.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, thank you again.
Well, thank you very much, Nick, for coming.
An arrow through the head isn't always a trick.
Much thanks again to Dr. Doyle for his generosity for showing me around his house and his studio. To see a gallery of that, visit the blog at www.departmentoftangents.com. You can also find out more about Dr. Doyle at www.informationphilosopher.com. And if you like the podcast, please subscribe on iTunes or Stitcher and consider leaving a review to help like-minded folks find the Department of Tangents blog and podcast. And we have come to our featured track for the episode, It's So Cruel from Ruby Boots. The song is from her second album and her first for Bloodshot Records, Don't Talk About It. I have only recently started to listen to Boots after getting an advance of the album, but what I do know is that she writes tough rock and roll songs and she has plenty of swagger. I'm looking forward to hearing the first album as well. You can find out about all of her music and tour dates at rubybootsmusic.com. Here's It's So Cruel from Ruby Boots.